مساء الخير. اوكي. In today's lecture, inshallah, we will be done with where we left off in the previous lecture with two drugs that are related to calcium metabolism and bone mineralization. And then we will start with the treatment of diabetes, and I'm targeting to get done with insulin. And inshallah, tomorrow we will start with the oral and injectable anti-diabetic agents. Okay, so we have two drugs for today from the previous lecture, starting from the parathyroid hormone. I would like to mention a few facts that will help you understand how parathyroid hormone is involved in the treatment of certain diseases. Now, the first thing to know is that parathyroid hormone counterintuitively is involved in two processes related to bone mineralization, which are the bone formation and the bone resorption, okay? Which is, I know it might be contradictory to what you know, and parathyroid hormone is involved in bone resorption. It's actually involved in both bone formation and bone resorption, acting particularly on osteoclasts and then activating the osteoblasts for the bone formation process. Now, what's important is to understand how that happens in real physiology, and this is actually related to how the release pattern of that parathyroid hormone happens. Fishy Abu Maher? Okay, Idan, when the parathyroid hormone is secreted inside the body in small and intermittent doses, it actually leads to a net result of bone formation in the body. Tamam? While if the secretion pattern of that parathyroid hormone goes into a very large and sustained doses, it actually induces a state of bone resorption. Tamam? This is how the body regulates the net effect of the parathyroid hormone, the secretion pattern of that hormone. Ilan, when we looked over time and when we discussed that parathyroid hormone activity over time, they found that during the early phases of the release of the parathyroid hormone, there actually is an increase in the bone formation markers. And this increase will get into a state of plateau after a while, and then will start going down. Now, the going down part of that is related to an increase, a simultaneous increase in the bone resorption marker. Now, as you can notice, we can draw something called the bone anabolic window in between the anabolic and the catabolic effects of parathyroid hormone, where there is a net increase in bone formation markers. This is called the bone anabolic window. Now, when they looked at the time frame of these effects, that they found that the anabolic window could last in periods between 6 and 12 months. And this could be used in pharmacology. As we discussed, we have a big problem, which is osteoporosis, where there is loss of bone mineralization density. Tamam? We can take advantage of the parathyroid hormone effect on the anabolic window to induce some sort of bone formation. So what they did is a production of a segment, a recombinant segment of that human parathyroid hormone, and producing a drug called teriparatide. Teriparatide is a very important drug that was introduced recently into the market as a part of the parathyroid hormone, and it's actually given both as subcutaneous injection once a day, tamam, which is very comfortable for the patient, and it can be used for up to 2 years. And you have to understand, based on what we discussed earlier, that this time limit, which is 2 years, is related to the fact that we are taking advantage of the anabolic window. After that, we don't want it. And what they found actually is that if you use it any beyond that, the 2 years period, you will get some sort of a risk of osteosarcoma, particularly when they tried it on animals, in rats. Tamam? And this teriparatide is the only drug available in the market, and mark my words, it's the only drug available in the market that induces directly bone formation. All other drugs we use are drugs that prevent bone resorption, بينما التيريباراتايد is a drug that induces bone formation. تمام؟ الآن when they used it as a second or third line option for the reduction in the risk of both vertebral and non-vertebral fractures. And if you can notice here the bone density of this vertebra, when you look at a patient who does not use teriparatide and on a patient who used teriparatide, there is a net formation of bone. And this was used actually clinically in the reduction of both vertebral and non-vertebral fractures. ولكن, since it is a very expensive drug, since it has a time limit of up to 2 years, after that you cannot use it anymore, it's not a first-line choice for the treatment of osteoporosis or vertebral fracture. But when you find that there is no other alternative, when the other drugs are not working enough as you want, then teriparatide becomes an option for you. Tamam? And particularly they used it in elderly patients that who are at risk of fractures. إذا صار عندهم fracture بتصير مصيبة. في patients ممكن يكون عندهم certain cardiovascular diseases or whatever. And if they get any kind of fracture, particularly the hip fracture وكذا, بيصيروا bedridden, بيصير في risk of deep vein thrombosis and so on. In these patients, we don't want them to get any type of fracture. So they might benefit from a trial of teriparatide, but again, for up to 2 years, after that you cannot use it anymore. Now, the other hormone involved in calcium metabolism, which is important to discuss here, is calcitonin. And a drug that's available as a drug extracted from the fish salmon. And that's why it's called salmon calcitonin. This salmon calcitonin, contradictory to what teriparatide does, it actually inhibits bone resorption. It does not stimulate bone formation, which is an important difference. تمام؟ فبالتالي this salmon calcitonin is used as a second or third or even a fourth choice in the treatment of osteoporosis لما كل الالترناتيف drugs are not working. There is no point of using teriparatide anymore. You want something to solve the problem, then salmon calcitonin might be of benefit for you. تمام؟ إذن it's not a first choice. Then what they found in salmon calcitonin is a very effective drug in the relief of post-fracture pain. الآن معروف بأنه bone fracture induces a very severe type of pain that might end up with a state of neurogenic shock. تمام؟ It's very severe. The patient might get into a shock just because of that severe pain from the fractures. When they tried salmon calcitonin, and they tried it actually interestingly by or through the intranasal route, they found that there is a reduction of these post-fracture pain. So actually in the US, they still rely on salmon calcitonin if the patient is having multiple and compound bone fractures, تمام? Just for the relief of pain. Left. We have to take care of the following. The first thing is that this salmon calcitonin is not the first choice. And the second thing is that when they looked at multiple clinical trials that use salmon calcitonin, they found that in something called meta-analysis. So they analyzed all the clinical trials that have been carried out on patients who use salmon calcitonin, that there was an increase in the risk of overall malignancy. لما يحكي overall malignancies, it's a weird thing. يعني إنه في patients زاد عنده colon cancer. في patients صار عنده lung cancer. في patients صار عنده osteosarcoma. في patients صار في عنده soft tissue tumor and so on. And they don't understand why. إنه it's increasing the overall malignancy. And that's why إنه they tell you, إنه if you want to use salmon calcitonin, just use it for short term and not for long term. Because of such risks. And the other thing they found also, in no sense, calcitonin is taken from the sand, which is something foreign to you. Your body will form some sort of autoantibodies, and that leads actually over the long run into the loss of response to such drug. And that's why you cannot use it anymore. And you are using it, you are inducing overall malignancies, but at the same time, you are not producing good effects of such drug. And that's why they recommend you not to use it for long, and not to use it. المرة الماضية نايم وهسه ماسك التليفون. قديش عمركم؟ المشكلة إنه أنت you know إنه I know you. فيعني يا بتنتبه مش عارف شو أسوي لك. Anyways, okay? And that's why we don't use such a drug for long periods of time. Just keep in mind إنه for the relief of post-fracture pains. تمام. لأن إحنا we will shift gears and move from this lecture about the bone mineralization into the diabetes topic. Any questions before we move? ما شاء الله عليكم كلكم فاهمين؟ Yes, yes sir.
آه.
That's a good question. No long-term clinical trials have been done using this concept. تمام. Other people ask this question, but there is no long-term clinical trial to report what happened. Thank you. That's a good question. Okay. الآن جينا the most interesting topic of this module, which is diabetes mellitus and the treatment of diabetes mellitus. And as I told the previous section, I'm happy you know I have taught you hypertension and diabetes now and the treatment thing, because these are the most common conditions that you will encounter in your fourth and sixth years. ويعني you have to expect to know the pediatric short case or the long case. There's something about hypertension or diabetes. تمام؟ You should know something about them. You should know how we deal with them, how we treat them, and so on. Now, before I get into the drugs and pharmacotherapy, I know boring things for you. Let me just give you some important concepts before we move into the pharmacotherapy. And to start with, I have to mention the goals of treatment, the overall goals for the treatment of diabetes. Now, this is important for me because you have to understand, وأعتقد ممكن يكون في public health lecture about diabetes, بأنه this is one of the most common chronic diseases in the world overall, وخاصة عندنا بالMiddle East, particularly because of the obesity rates. This is a chronic disease, so patients who live with type 1, they might live with that for 40 or 50 years. Patients with type 2, they encounter that in their 20s or 30s, and then they have to live with it for 30 years or something. So it's a very chronic, debilitating condition that needs a huge attention from the patient, from the families, from the physician, and from the nutritionist, and so on. بكل العالم بطلوا يتعاملوا مع مرضى الدايابيتس انه من منظور one physician per patient. صار في groups to work with each diabetic patient. في group تحتوي على endocrinologist, على واحد nutritionist, على واحد بيشتغل على ال exercise and so on. حتى psychiatrist. They include a psychiatrist in the treatment of diabetes because of it. It's very debilitating outcomes on the patient. And the goals are as follows. The first one is to control symptoms and to relieve the symptoms of hyperglycemia. And such symptoms have a wide variety of presentations. يعني hyperglycemia could affect your eye, your head, your legs, everywhere. It could hit everywhere. وبالتالي احنا we have to control hyperglycemia to control the occurrence of symptoms. And we have two other things that are major goals of the therapy of diabetes. The first one is the prevention of acute complications. As you know, in diabetes, one can type 1 or type 2 could end up with life-threatening emergency conditions, like diabetic ketoacidosis, one non-ketotic hyperosmolar stage. We have to prevent them. If they happen, it means the patient is not well-treated and they are at risk of death. Diabetic ketoacidosis as a case is very severe that might end up with death. كذلك in non-ketotic hyperosmolar states. So we prevent them. On the other hand, we limit the occurrence and the speed of chronic complications of diabetes. We cannot actually prevent them. This is something inevitable. You know, there should be chronic complications. And these chronic complications include both the microvascular, اللي هم retinopathy, nephropathy, neuropathy. In addition also to the macrovascular complications, مثل الاثيروسكلروسيس والperipheral vascular disease. We limit them, we do not stop them. In most cases, they should happen in the patient. And finally, by doing such things, controlling the symptoms, preventing acute complications, and limiting the long-term complications, you're actually improving the life of this patient. a patient who's not dealing with regular, مثلا, infection for 2 weeks وخلاص بتعدي. يعيش مع المرض for 40 سنة. Which is not a nice thing to have. لأن, is it worth it? Is it worth it to have all this harassment of dealing with the disease, with treating it, وتحط كل هال support group for the patient? يعني شو النتيجة من كل هالحكي؟ They actually did that, and they did that over in the US and in the UK. And one of the most important studies was done or was carried out in the UK, which followed diabetic patients for almost 10 or 20 years. I'm not sure exactly of the time period. Called the UK Prospective Diabetes Study. And they followed the patient and they categorized them. Patients who were well controlled for diabetes, or patients اللي بط ما كان عندهم good control of diabetes. They found that it is worth it. The microvascular complications, they are reduced. The patients, they did not lose their vision from retinopathy. Patients did not get into dialysis state because of nephropathy. So it's working. At the same time, the occurrence of the cardiovascular complications, like, for example, atherosclerosis or coronary artery disease, they were reduced as a frequency and as a severity. And finally, the mortality rates of the patients was less over long periods of time. So it is worth it. حتى لو المريض هذا مش your relative, it is worth it for the long term. And keep in mind, you know, this is a public health problem. وانت as a general physician, اهم اشي بحياتك مش التخصص انك تكون تعرف كيف تعمل عملية قلب مفتوح. No, انت المهم بالنسبة لك as a GP, انه how to deal with public health problem. This is how we graduate you and what we expect you to care about at the end of your studying here. So it is worth it. Ilan, unfortunately, there are certain things about diabetes that are bad and we have to deal with them with several mechanisms related actually to the relative insulin secretion in diabetic patients over time. Ilan, can we cure the disease? We cannot cure the disease as it stands right now, because if we look at the relative insulin secretion in diabetic patients over time, we will find that there is a very progressive reduction in the amount of insulin in their bodies, reaching down to zero at one point. If a kind of type 1 diabetic patient starting from the scratch as a zero insulin secretion, for type 2 you have to know most of them will end up with a stage of zero insulin secretion because it happens as a progressive outcome of the disease. Then we developed several ways to deal with such relative deficiency of insulin secretion, and this could be according to the stage of insulin secretion. What we found is that in dieting and exercising for those diabetic patients is enough actually during the early phases of the disease of accounting for 10 to 15% of the relative insulin secretion deficiency. يعني the patient إذا عمل good diet وعمل good exercise والإنسولين deficiency عنده is not that bad, يعني 10 to 15% exercise and diet will be enough. بس المشكلة إنه إحنا we don't catch the patients at such stages. والمشكلة الثانية إنه مرضانا أصلا هو جايك obese, وبالتالي he hates exercise, he hates diet, إنه to have a good controlled dieting program, وبالتالي it gets into a vicious cycle. So this does not work very often in our patient. Now, during which, and once this fails to account for the deficiency, you have to start with treatment. And whenever the patient is started on treatment, we start them on a single therapy, as we will discuss tomorrow. But we know it as a matter of fact, at one point, this will not suffice. It's not going to be enough to account for the deficiency, and we have to start them on combination therapies. Yeah, I'm telling the patient taking 3 or 4 anti-diabetic agents, one can oral or injectable. And the problem becomes, at the end, the patient will get into a state where there is no insulin, and the drugs, the oral drugs do not work anymore, and the patient should be started on insulin. Why do patients hate using insulin? Because it's injectable. And the patient has to use the injection multiple times per day, subcutaneously, which is painful. Tamam? And notice that there is an overlap at one point. We might use insulin and the combination therapy together to account for the deficiency of insulin secretion. Now, if we look at the natural history of both type 1 and type 2, we will find that in type 2 patients, we actually catch them at a stage where the diet and exercise is not enough anymore, and we have to start them on single drug therapy. Now, in 5 to 15 years, that's the only time limit you have to use the oral drugs. After that, the best situation, in 15 years using oral drugs. بعد هيك, whatever you do, they have to be started on what? On insulin. And that's when the long-term complications have actually started in the patient, and they start having problems with their eyes, with their kidneys, with their legs, with everything. أما with type 1, it's the opposite. We actually catch them at a stage where there is no insulin secretion at all, and we cannot use the oral drugs. We have to depend and rely only on insulin injections. Now, what we will discuss today is only insulin and how to deal with insulin and what different types of insulin are available to you in the market. And to start with, just a warm-up for that, let me just remind you of the indications of using insulin in diabetic patients. The first one, as you know, of course, it's type 1 diabetes. You cannot use any other than insulin in type 1 diabetic patients. They will not respond. Because type 1 diabetics do not have any kind of insulin secretion in their body. Now, type 2, on the other hand, you have to use it in certain situations. The first one, it's an uncontrolled diabetes type 2. يعني the patient is put on 3 drugs ولسه عنده hyperglycemia. تعرف level of glucose up to 100. تلاقي هذول patients ماشيين على 4 drugs وستيل عندهم hyperglycemia 400 or more. تمام? Which is very bad. Oh, type 2 diabetic patient, and she got pregnant. During pregnancy, all patients have to be shifted into insulin injection. تمام? Because most of the oral anti-diabetic agents are contraindicated. Although one of them currently is not contraindicated, but trust me, most physicians do not risk using oral drugs for the treatment of diabetes in pregnant ladies. تمام? And the other thing, once a diabetic patient, so one can type 1 or type 2, got into an acute complication state. So one can have diabetic ketoacidosis or in non-osmolar ketotic hyper, complication of diabetes. يعني بالإمرجنسي, يعني المريض ممكن يموت. So you have to start them on insulin. And finally, if a diabetic patient, type 2, حتى لو كان controlled, قبل يدخل المستشفى, once they get into surgery, or can they have multiple trauma in their body, any stressful situation, any stressful, serious systemic infection, in such cases, you have to start the patient on insulin. So it is actually something that you have to know how to deal with. Yes.
So what are DKA and
NKHA? حكيت diabetic ketoacidosis and non-ketotic hyperosmolar state. It's an acute complication of diabetes related to two things. Very severe hyperglycemia. Well, other thing, formation of ketone bodies due to the bad metabolism during the loss of insulin. And I guess the pathology لازم نحكي لكم عنها. حتى لو ما حكي لكم مش عنها السنة الجاية راح تاخدوها كثير. السنة الرابعة. المهم اسمهم acute complications of diabetes. الآن, when you go to any book, you will find that we have 4 different types of insulin available to you. When I know from the previous sections, dealing with such different types is hard, the student. You have to memorize certain things to know the differences between them. So I try to simplify it as much as I can. Now, with all the four types of insulin we're going to deal with, I will have this key to differentiate between the different types according to this pharmacological key. This key means, and we will differentiate between the 4 different types according to the onset, يعني كم بياخذ وقت من الوقت اللي انا بعطي فيه الانجكشن للpatient لبين ما يبلش يتحسن عنده الهايبرغليسيميا. This is called onset. And the peak action, how long does it take to get the maximum effect of that drug? It's important to know that لأنه أنت إذا كان عندك hyperglycemia or certain level you want to reduce it through this peak action. تمام؟ So we have to understand how long it takes to get into that peak action. And finally, the fourth thing is the duration of action of that drug, because it's going to be important how to deal with diabetic patients over the day. And should we use it once, twice, three times or more during the day? Now, to make an analogy, something simple as an example. If there is one insulin that looks like how the regular insulin in your body works, I'm going to call it the regular, and it's called in books as regular insulin. Imagine that I have to travel to my target تبعي هناك عند هاي الستيج. Regular insulin takes me to my target driving a car. تمام؟ Why? There is another type of insulin that will take me to my target driving a plane. On the other hand, we have a much slower insulin that takes me to my target using a bicycle, and it's called an intermediate insulin. And there is a fourth type of insulin that will take forever to get you into your target, just like walking into your target. And this is called the long-acting insulin. I guess by understanding this analogy, it's going to be very easy for you to draw the figures, the onset, peak action, and duration of action. Let's start. The regular insulin, if we draw the plasma insulin levels against time, then this is the regular insulin. It's an insulin that will not have an onset very quickly. I mean, it might take up to half an hour to get some sort of effect. At the same time, the peak of that is not very big. It's not plateaued, it's not rounded. And the duration of action is moderate. 4 to 6 to 8 hours maximum. This is the regular insulin. And this regular insulin is the one we actually use as a subcutaneous injection and sometimes, or actually it's the most commonly used one, as IV in emergency state. So one can have diabetic ketoacidosis or others. Lan, this might not be your best choice for every single indication of diabetes. Why? Because imagine we are dealing with an emergency condition. We need something to produce an effect very rapidly. So they produce another type of insulin, and the action of that insulin looks like this. The onset is almost immediate. وبالتالي إذا الpatient هلا أكل, they might take the injection right now, and it's going to produce the effect immediately. عشان هيك تسمعوا في مرضى diabetes بيحكوا لهم خذ الجرعة إما مع الأكل أو حتى يعني immediately بعد ما أكلت أول كم نغمة, that's fine. Why? Because the onset is very quick. بينما مع الريجولر no, it takes up to half an hour. فشو لازم أحكي للpatient اللي بده يستخدم الإنسولين هذا؟ Exactly. You have to take it before meal in about 15 to 30 minutes so that you can get some sort of onset and then the peak action. While in the rapid, it's immediate. وبالتالي يعني for example ممكن type 1 diabetic يجاله هسا صحن كنافة and he has to eat it. What's the best choice to use? Rapid. كل الديابيتكس by the way بتلاقيهم حاميين محهم. Rapid acting insulin because it's gonna help them if they are in a stressful situation of كنافة. تمام? They have to use it now or to take it now. But what's the problem with this? The duration is very minimal. يعني إنه up to 4 hours. يعني المريض إذا بده ياخده أو بده تغطي حياته خلال اليوم, he has to use this injection how many times? 6 times. وتخيل إنه مريض has to be injected subcutaneously 6 times. It does not work. And that's why we cannot use it alone as a treatment of diabetes. Lan, so it's again, a subcutaneous injection could be used as an IV drug in emergency conditions. And it has the largest peak. Lan, we have the most commonly used type of insulin, which is actually the one that you are most comfortable dealing with. لأن الكاركترستكس تبعته make sense to you. ليش? Because it looks like this. Now notice that the onset of action is not quick. يعني it might take up to 1 and 1.5 hours to get some sort of action. But شو البنفيت هون؟ قبل الديوريشن، a long peak of action. يعني في بلاتو، يعني هو بوصل للبيك اوف اكشن وبضله for long periods of time which might stay up to 8 hours وهو لساته بالبيك. فمعناته انت شو ما اكلت خلال البيك هاي it will be solved. تمام؟ And notice that the duration could reach up to 18 hours. So you might ask the patient to take it only once per day. So that's why it's considered one of the most commonly used types and the patients are most comfortable dealing with. It's used only as a subcutaneous injection. We cannot use it as an IV injection. And importantly, it was formed chemically to precipitate at the site of injection. يعني absorption of this drug from the subcutaneous tissue is slow. And that's why it gets a very long peak. They introduced a newer type. And this newer type is the long-acting. You have a long-acting that you have to walk to reach your target. This long-acting insulin looks like this. Advantage is huge. You only use it once per day. It covers you throughout the day. It's up to 24 hours and even longer. But what's the problem? The first one is that the onset is very slow. And the second one, there's no peak. It's like a line. يعني هو بلش من هون لحد النهاية and there is no peak. فمعناته this might cover you in just certain situations, but the big advantage is that it takes or it covers you for a very long time, so you might only need to use it once per day. Again, it's a drug that's used subcutaneously. It precipitates at the injection site to tell slow absorption. The important thing is that you cannot mix it with any other drugs in the same syringe. Why? Because you might change the chemistry of that drug of telly to lose its efficacy. Now, to understand the differences, we have to draw them all on top of each other. If this is the regular one, who that simulates your body's secretion of insulin. تمام? Your body's endogenous insulin. تمام? Notice the rapid one, which is an immediate onset, a very big peak. تمام? The largest peak, actually, of all of them. But at the same time, it's a poor drug because it covers you only for 4 to 6 hours maximum. Beyond that, you cannot use it. بينما notice this intermediate acting insulin. It's one of the most commonly used. Why? Because it has a very long peak. تمام? It gets a maximal effect and stays there. بينما notice this long acting. It's peakless. It does not have a peak. فمعناته المريض, it covers him during the day. ولكن إذا إجا عباله يأكلك نافع, it does not cover you. Does not have a peak. لا. Yes, go خلينا هلا نحكي. Thank you. Good question. Yes.
So, intermediate
بكتفه فيه. يعني حتى لو عنده وجبات أكل. هلا نحكي. لا. In general, يا شباب. In general. In all endocrinology problems. أنت شو المشكلة عندك بالإندوكراين سيستم؟ Hormone that is produced in your body to function in a certain way. And it got lost. بطلت موجودة. فشو لازم تساوي؟ لازم تعملها replacement. Replacement هاي لازم تكون exactly how it works in your body. فهذا اللي بنسميه simulation of the normal secretion pattern. Simulation. يعني انت تقلد ما هو موجود داخل الجسم. انت بكاش تخترع العجلة من جديد. بكل الاندوكراين problems you have to simulate the normal secretion pattern. Then if we look at how the insulin is secreted during the day, they found this thing. The first thing, we have a basal insulin secretion level, which means that insulin never gets to zero levels at any time during the day. فمعناها المريض اللي عنده type 1 diabetes, he cannot be without insulin for any period of time. لازم to be covered all the day. اسمها basal insulin. But at the same time, in any regular subject, any regular, normal subject, he has or she has 3 surges or 3 peaks of insulin secretion per day, which coincide with what? With meals. This is breakfast, this is lunch, and this is dinner. طبعا نحكي عن regular, normal subject. الآن, if you want to treat diabetes, you have to do the same. You have to look the same. If you don't do this, the diabetic patients will not be covered well, وبالتالي he might develop acute with long-term complications. Then why is it important to have this basal insulin secretion? Because we are afraid of fasting hyperglycemia. لأنه البيشنت اللي تعشى ونام تمام الساعة 12 بالليل رح يصحى الصبح شو يكون عنده الليفل اوف هايبرجلايسيميا 400 and more if you don't have the basal level of insulin secretion تمام so you have to cover them basally. الآن from discussing the four different types if I want to achieve the basal insulin secretion which types of insulin should I use? Exactly. It's either the long or the intermediate. These are the insulin types that cover you for long periods of time without a peak, or حتى البيك بيكون for long periods of time covering me at the basal level. But at the same time, إذا البيشنت إجا بيفطر ولا يتغدى ولا إجا أكل حلو and so on, these drugs will not cover you. So what should you do? You have to use either the regular or rapid acting insulin to cover such needs. And that's why when we treat diabetic patients with insulin, we either use one of the following scenarios. We might use a long acting insulin once a day at bedtime and it will cover them, get this, up to 24 hours. So the basal levels are achieved. بس إذا إجا تغدى أو تعشى أو أفطر شو لازم ياخذ؟ لازم ياخذ a different type of insulin سواء كانت الريجولار او ايش او الرابيد acting insulin
حتى
واللونج
شغال يعني
حتى واللونج شغال اللونج will cover the basal needs بس انت عارف انه اذا اكلت شو راح يصير بالنيد it will be increased so you have to cover the patient by either using the rapid او regular type of insulin تمام لكن وين المشكله هون المشكلة إنه هذا المريض بده to be injected 1, 2, 3, 4 times 1, 2, 3, 4 times 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 5 times a day it sucks مش معقول إنه خلي patient to be injected 5 times a day it's painful وتذكر إحنا we're not dealing with a condition that will fade away within weeks ولا months ولا years it's gonna stay with them for 4 years or more تمام وبالتالي you have to find a good solution for them Lam, a good solution was found when we introduced the pre-mixed preparations. Lam, they produce a special type of insulin injection. يحتوي على two types of insulin. The regular insulin and the intermediate insulin. الانترميديت شو الهدف منه؟ To cover the basal needs. والregular to cover شو؟ Meal-induced surges. In such cases, you are able to give the drug only twice, فقط two injections per day. And they divide the dose actually into two-thirds in the morning, لأنه it's the big chunk. You have to cover the breakfast, the fasting hyperglycemia, the breakfast and the lunch. بعدين تيجي بتعطي another injection in the evening to cover شو? To cover for the dinner and the nighttime hyperglycemia. So such preparation was very good for patients because it covered them for their basal and meal-induced surges at the same time with much less injections per day. لأن كل اللي بنعرفه عن الانسولين انه it was previously used انه بتيجي بتعطي للمريض ampule of insulin وبتعطيه هاي السيرنج وبدك تحكي للمريض انه يجي وياخذ من السيرنج الدوس اللي انت كاتب له اياها يعني بده يرفع هون 10 ولا 11 ولا 15 ml بعدين يعطيها لحاله المشكله وين كانت تصير انه this is hard يعني بلكي المريض ما بيعرفش يقرا بيعرفش يكتب بيعرفش يعني most of them are old illiterate whatever يعني فبالتالي it was hard on patient so one of the best inventions of our time was the introduction of this meter pen هذا الميتر بن هو يتميز بعده امور الامر الاول إنه it has a digital screen هون مش digital هي يعني البن you can بس بتلفه على الدوس اللي انت بدك اياها بدك 10 بدك 11 بدك 12 whatever تمام and they can see إنه this is the actual dose or not ما فيها أي any kind of misunderstanding تمام the other thing is that you can carry it in your pocket it's a pen that is mobile يعني you can carry it without affecting the drug ومن دون أي خوف على إنه الدرج يخرب أو لا. وبالتالي it was very great for the patients, تمام, and very easy on patients. Something new, although not too new, إنه the pump, which is a pump that is implanted intradermally, يعني بالabdomen actually. وهاي تتميز بأنه فيها شغلتين, فيها sensor, هذا السنسر بحس كمية الجلوكوز اللي موجودة in the blood. وعلى أساسها شو بيقرر؟ بيقرر إنه كمية جرعة الإنسولين اللي بدك تعطيها للpatient. It was great. بس المشكلة إنه very expensive. وبالتالي هي موجودة عنده بمستشفى واحد بالأردن فقط اللي بيعملها. والشغلة الثانية إنه هاي الإنسولين كارتج اللي موجود فيها بيخلص منه. فبدك تيجي تفتح وتبدلها من جديد. والبطارية شو بتصير فيها؟ ممكن تخرب. السنسر ممكن يخرب. وبالتالي you have to repeat the procedure several times to get the result you want. تمام؟ بكل الأحوال we are dealing with an injection. And this injection, the subcutaneous injection, is somehow important to know إنه how to deal with it, إنه how to communicate with your patient. What we know إنه we have four or three regions to use the subcutaneous insulin in, which are the abdomen, buttocks, and the arms. And they differ from each other in the speed of absorption of the drug. يعني إذا المريض بحاجة إلى إنه absorption of the drug very rapidly, they have to use the abdominal area لأنه the absorption is very fast. بينما if it doesn't matter, إنه you have to use what the buttocks because they have a very slow absorption time. المهم بالنسبة لي, I'm not teaching nurses. I'm teaching you as physicians because it's important to tell your patient that you cannot use the same area of injection all the time. يعني ما بصيرش المريض إنه يضلوا يعمل injection لحاله in the abdomen at the same area because this is bad. Why is it bad? I'm gonna show you a picture in a minute. What we actually recommend the patient to do is rotation of injection sites. يعني إذا أخذت الجرعة الصباحية بالبطك, الجرعة المسائية بالأبدومن, الجرعة اللي بعدها بالأرم, and so on. You cannot use the same site repeatedly. Now, what are we afraid of? Should side effects of this insulin? The most important thing, of course, is hypoglycemia. يعني الpatient اللي بهمس يسكت. اللي بهمس يسكت. The patient who has diabetes, and you might know whether they are using insulin or oral antidiabetic agents, we are afraid of hypoglycemia. Hypoglycemia is something that could kill the patient actually. You know, they might reach levels of blood sugar less than 40, which are very risky on the brain of the patient. لأن هاي symptoms تتراوح من just headache, anxiety, tachycardia, ممكن vertigo, ممكن sweating, ممكن numbness in the perioral area, and so on. كل هاي symptoms تنتهي بإيش؟ تنتهي بكوما. تمام؟ Well, this is risky on the patient, you know, to get into a coma. لأن المشكلة بأنه زي ما حكيت بالأول بأنه most of our diabetic patients are actually hypertensive. لما نحكي بأنهم hypertensive معناته they are using what? البيتا بلوكر, سواء كانوا selective أو non-selective beta blocker. شو بصير باللي بيستخدم البيتا بلوكر؟ كل السيمتومز هاي will be blocked. لأنه أصلا السيمتومز هاي جاي من وين؟ جاي من sympathetic overactivity. ليش؟ لأنه إذا قل مستوى الإنسولين الكاتيكولامينز بتزيد وبالتالي بتصير هاي السيمتوم. فإف يو جيف أني كايند أوف بيتا بلوكر تو أ دايابيتيك بيشنت إت مايت ماسك ذا سيمتومز أوف هايبوغلايسيميا. بالتالي المريض بدل ما إنه يكون عارف إنه والله أنا عندي هايبوغلايسيميا, طب ولا هو شو صار فيه؟ كوم. Exactly. If you don't modify the dose of beta blocker, lots of these patients might be comatose before they know إنه they have hypoglycemia. Finally, what I discussed earlier about the injection site, المشكلة بأنه the injection repeatedly of insulin into one site might be complicated by either lipoatrophy, يعني كل الفات تيشو اللي موجود inside, for example, the abdomen will die, أو إنه dystrophy, بدل ما إنه it dies, إنه it's replaced by fibrous tissue وبتكبر بتنتفخ زي هيك. المشكلة إيش؟ المشكلة إنه this is what's gonna happen to your dose. This is called erratic absorption. يعني أنت بتعطي dose for the patient. Sometimes they might get a maximal absorption. ولا the patient صار عنده hypoglycemia. باليوم الثاني ما صارش في absorption at all. والpatient شو صار عنده؟ Hyperglycemia. And that's why you cannot have this side effect. This side effect has to be prevented by rotating the sites of injection. Previously, this was a very common problem. لأنه الانسولين was produced from cows, from animals. تالي كان يصير في allergic reaction وتلاقي المريض اللي بيستخدم الانسولين اجره بتنفخ الجلد. بينما حاليا we don't extract insulin from cows, from animals, we actually produce it by recombinant DNA technology. And that's why we don't have any allergic reactions anymore. ولكن you might get such things if you constantly inject insulin at a particular site in the body. تمام؟ Any questions? Good.